He does.
Salt Lake Community College student Carolyn Bird will sing the Star Spangled Banner for us, after which we will be seated for the invocation by the Reverend Arvin Haynes.
what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallant.
Please be seated.
Would you bow your heads and hearts with me today? Heavenly Father, we come before you at this time of the inauguration ceremony of President Cundiff to ask your blessing. As Jabez in the days of old had a heart filled with specific requests that you granted, I ask these blessings today with purpose and assurance of your great care for your children. I ask you to bless Dr. Cundiff upon his inauguration today as president of Salt Lake Community College. I ask you to bless the rest of his family, his wife Glenda. We ask for the blessing upon the governing body, upon the staff, upon the faculty, upon the student body, upon the guests that are assembled today at this great institution of higher learning. I ask you to increase President Cundiff's wisdom and insight as he leads this community of educators and students. Please allow his influence to increase beyond this valley to impact this state and the world. Father, I am humbled and honored that you would allow us today to have access to your throne room of grace, to let our petitions be known before you. Thank you for that privilege. I thank you today, Father, for President Cundiff. I thank you for all your many blessings to us. And I thank you for hearing and answering my prayer today. In Jesus' name, amen.
This is a wonderful occasion for Salt Lake Community College today. We'd like to welcome students, faculty, staff, faculty emeriti, alumni, Commissioner Foxley, other members of the Board of Regents, Board of Trustees, past presidents, representatives of the nine surrounding colleges and universities, family and friends of the president, community members, and other honored guests. Welcome to the inauguration ceremony of Dr. H. Lynn Cundiff as the sixth president of Salt Lake Community College. The procession today was led by the Utah Pipe Band. Carolyn Bird, a student in general studies at Salt Lake Community College, has just sung the Star-Spangled Banner. And I was told that Since the age of 12, Carolyn has been trying out for the plays here at the college, never having been selected. So this was a great day for her, and her chance has finally come, and we see what great talent she has. Reverend Arvin Haynes of the Salt Lake Christian Center has given our invocation. We would like to thank our interpreters for the deaf, Kim Medina and Danielle Crosby. I am Randall Mackey, Chair of the Salt Lake Community College Board of Trustees. Allow me to introduce our platform guests. As they stand, please hold your applause until all platform guests are introduced. From my right, Dr. Cecilia Foxley, Commissioner for the Utah System of Higher Education. Olene Walker, Lieutenant Governor. Dr. H. Lynn Cundiff, President of Salt Lake Community College. Mrs. Glenda S. Cundiff. Charles E. Johnson, Chair of the Utah State Board of Regents. Dr. Barry Newbold, Superintendent of the Jordan School District. Charlene Luke, Faculty Senate President. Michael Thurman, Staff Association President. Maxine Robinson Swenson, Alumni Association Vice President. Reverend Arvin Haynes of the Salt Lake Christian Center. Carolyn Bird, a student in general studies at the Salt Lake Community College. Then, first row on my left here, Trustee Norman Riggs, Vice Chair of the Board of Trustees of the college. Jacob Packer, student body president for this academic year and member of the Board of Trustees. Trustee Mary Bangeter, member of the Board of Trustees. Trustee Ellen Bennett, member of the Board of Trustees. Trustee David Thomas, member of the Board of Trustees. And Trustee Thomas Forsgren, member of the Board of Trustees. In the second row, on my left, Most Reverend George Niederauer of the Catholic Diocese of Salt Lake. Dr. Joan Lord, Vice President of Academic Affairs for Floyd College in Rome, Georgia. Regent Pamela Atkinson, member of the Board of Regents. Regent Brent Hogan, member of the Board of Regents. Regent George Mantis, member of the Board of Regents. And Regent Maria Sweeten, member of the Board of Regents. To my far left, going right, Dr. Frank Budd, President Emeritus. Dr. Richard Rhodes, Vice President of Business Services. Dr. Jeffrey Brugger, Executive Dean, South City Campus. Elwood Zog, Executive Dean for Career and Technical Programs. Dr. Marjorie Carson, Vice President of Academic Services and Grand Marshal. Brent Goodfellow, Vice President of Community, State, and National Affairs. Dr. John Angewarden, Executive Dean, Jordan Campus. Dr. Daniel Bingham, Executive Dean, Larry H. Miller Campus. And Dr. David Richardson, Executive Dean, Redwood Road Campus. And Dr. Helen Cox, Interim Assistant to the President. Not seated on the stage, but running around orchestrating the events for the day, is Judd Morgan, Student Services Vice President. Please join me in welcoming these guests and others seated in the audience today. These proceedings are being transmitted worldwide through the internet. What you see on the screen to my left is what is being sent. As we continue further into our program, we are pleased to hear from the Salt Lake Community College South City Jazz Group as they perform the musical number Reach Higher. Following their number, we will hear salutations from entities which encompass our college and the college community as listed in our program. On behalf of the students, we will hear from Jacob Packard, student body president for the 2002-01 year, from the faculty, Faculty Senate President Charlene Luke, from the staff, Staff Association President Michael Thurman, representing the alumni, Maxine Robinson Swenson, Alumni Association Vice President. Following the alumni salutation, we will hear from Dr. Barry Newbold, Superintendent of the Jordan School District. Dr. Cecilia H. Foxley, Commissioner of Utah System of Higher Education, will next speak. Representing Floyd College of Rome, Georgia, where President Cundiff last served as president, will be Dr. Joan M. Lord, Vice President of Academic Affairs. And representing the state of Utah, the following, the Honorable Olene Walker, Lieutenant Governor for the state of Utah. Following the salutations, there will be another musical number There is one of these, this is one of those moments performed by the South City Jazz, and we will go to that point. Thank you.
When I sent out the invitations, I didn't think so many of you would come to see me off, but I thank you. I have a little brother that loves animals, and one time he talked my mother into taking him to the swap meet to buy some baby chickens. So she goes and she buys him 4 baby chickens. He brings them home and decides he would like to teach them how to fly. So what does he do? He gets all 4 of these baby chickens. He walks up onto this little rock wall that we have in our backyard, and he puts them on top of the wall. Luckily, there's grass on the bottom, so don't think that any chickens are going to die in this story. But he puts them on the wall, and he puts them on the edge, and he encourages them and pushes them off the edge. But guess what happened? They just fell down on the grass. He tried another one. He got the next one up there, did the same thing, encouraged, pushed it off the ledge, but the darn thing wouldn't fly. So he gets another one. He did this with 4 chickens before he realized maybe chickens can't fly. And so it's a powerful lesson that I apply to education. You might think, how does he apply this to education? But oftentimes we as students find ourselves in this position. We're on top of a rock wall, and we're being encouraged by the world to fly. We look back on our education for the knowledge, and oftentimes we cannot find it. You see, education is an experience and not just an occurrence. The fruit of our education as students can be gauged by how much we contribute back to society. Now the success of Salt Lake Community College can be gauged in that very same manner. What we contribute back to society after we graduate. We must learn about life if we are to be successful in life. Now, President Cundiff is a man that understands this very well. In fact, one of the first speeches that I heard him give, he quoted a poem by a man named R.L. Sharp. The poem goes a bit like this. Isn't it strange that princes and kings and clowns that caper in sawdust rings and common people like you and me are builders of an eternity? Each is given a bag of tools, a formless mass, and a book of rules. And each must make, ere life has flown, a stumbling block or a stepping stone. In President Cundiff, I see a man that understands the concept of education and more so understands his role, the role that he plays in the lives of students. On behalf of the students, I would like to welcome him into our lives and tell him that we eagerly anticipate the fruits of his leadership. Leaving you with the words of Longfellow, who said, the lives of great men remind us that our lives too can be sublime, and parting leave behind us footprints in the sands of time. You see, the true testament of leadership is its ability to inspire, and I would like to thank President Cundiff for inspiring me as a student to become better, along with thousands of other students that he has inspired along the way.
Jake, you have been wonderful this year. I'd like to congratulate you for all the hard work you've done. You've done wonderful and set a high standard for the students here at Salt Lake Community College. I'm really humbled at this time. With all these higher education people standing here behind me, I don't know. I think I'd sooner have them in front of me than behind me. But respected colleagues, students, honored guests, it's a pleasure to be here this afternoon to participate in officially welcoming Dr. H. Lynn Cundiff to Salt Lake Community College. Since he came last August, Dr. Cundiff has helped us in reorganizing our college, our campuses, and we have been on an exciting, wonderful trip at that time. Not only have we reorganized the campuses and the college, but we have been reorganizing the staff, the students, and the faculty organizations. We have been working with technology for some time, however. However, we, at this time, jumped on a bandwagon that we didn't dream it was possible. And we have been on a hard trip ever since. We've been looking at distance education, wireless communication and devices, e-books, and paperless offices. It has been and will be a time for change, and in the future it will be exciting and very innovative. Under President Cundiff's direction, I'm confident that it will be a time to exchange ideas and work together for the betterment of Salt Lake Community College. For those faculty who are innovative and creative in their teaching, the future is yours. Take the initiative, dream the dream, and work hard to accomplish it. Not everyone is excited and willing to step forward to help bring about the changes, but the change will happen. Whether you are racing ahead or being drugged, kicking and screaming all the way, let's work together to make Salt Lake Community College a national and internationally recognized college. Let's follow Dr. Cundiff to the future. On behalf of the faculty of Salt Lake Community College, I would like to welcome Dr. H. Lynn Cundiff and his wife, Glenda, to Salt Lake Community College. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Glenda and President Cundiff, honored guests from the community and around the country, state educational leaders, friends and benefactors of the college, faculty and students of Salt Lake Community College, on behalf of the nearly 1,600 full and part-time employees of this growing institution, may I say, welcome, President Cundiff. And after 9 months of living together, I'm very happy that today's ceremony means we're finally getting married. Last week, I met a former associate of President Cundiff. And I was walking up to him to introduce myself. He suddenly said, "I can see you're suffering from Cundiffitis." Obviously brought on by Cundiff vision. So now we have two new words for our college lexicon. He assured me, however, that the condition was benign and rarely fatal. One may, however, pass through times of stark terror. He related that on one occasion, President Cundiff and several of his chief administrators were going to Wake Forest University. And President Cundiff and a vice president flew in the president's private plane up there, and the rest drove. On the return trip, however, it appears that the vice president insisted on driving the 6 hours back with the others. What's up with that? Maybe he does his performance evaluation while stunt flying. If I can sum up the last 9 months in one word, it might be chaos. But in the words of Margaret Wheatley, we need to accept chaos as an essential process by which natural systems, including organizations, renew and revitalize themselves. So chaos is not necessarily a bad thing. The natural world we live in and the social orders we have created for ourselves are naturally chaotic and require constant change to negotiate. Quoting former Supreme Court Justice William O. Douglas, "The search for static security is misguided. The fact is, security can only be achieved through constant change, adapting old ideas that have outlived their usefulness to current facts." So thank you, President Cundiff, for leading us through chaos on a journey of change. Your vision for the college is tangible, your leadership style is refreshing, and your human concern for each of us is noted and appreciated. Even though some of us might follow your vision kicking and screaming or mumbling and grumbling at times, I think that one day we will, after honest reflection, look back and fully appreciate the destination and recognize that we have grown during the journey, individually as well as institutionally. We are therefore committed to learning at the speed of life. Again, welcome to you and Glenda, especially Glenda. And may we all remember the words of the naturalist Charles Darwin: "It is not the strongest of the species that survive, nor the most intelligent, but the most to change." And one last word: if you can't be a good example, then you'll just have to serve as a horrible warning. Thank you.
Good afternoon, fellow friends of the college. It is a great honor for me to address you here today on behalf of the Alumni Association. Many of you may have noticed the beautiful flowers, green grass, and trees as you arrived here today. Spring is my favorite time of year, and for good reason. It is a season of new growth and development. The trees, the grass, and the flowers all represent new growth for the new season. As I looked around at the beauty springtime has to offer, I realized that that is exactly what we are celebrating here today, a new beginning here at Salt Lake Community College. With the addition of President Cundiff here at the institution, we look forward to the new growth and development that we will experience here at the college. I am proud to be an alumni of 6 years of this institution. I attended the college 6 years ago, and as I moved on to continue my education, it was then that I realized the great benefits that the college had to offer me. I gained a greater appreciation for the education I had received while attending the college. With the many great opportunities the college provided me, I felt it was necessary I give back my time and energies to further promote and develop the institution, in hopes that past, present, and future students could personally experience the benefits the college has to offer. Becoming a member of the Alumni Association allowed me to do this. The Alumni Association has grown and expanded with the college. Today we have over 250,000 alumni. The mission statement of the alumni reflects the efforts of continuous improvement made by the association. This mission is accomplished through increasing the visibility of Salt Lake Community College throughout the community, promoting educational and professional development, and encourage philanthropic giving. In the future, we hope to continually increase the number of awarded scholarships to the students attending the college and build stronger community ties. We are here to link past, present, and future students with the college. Learning is a lifelong process, and regardless of a student's journey after attending the college, the alumni will continue to support and assist those students. The college provides a strong foundation for students to build their future on, and we look forward to President Cundiff's vision and direction for the future here of Salt Lake Community College as we grow and expand. On behalf of the Alumni Association, we would like to welcome President Cundiff and his wife, Glenda. Thank you.
President and Mrs. Cundiff, distinguished guests, faculty, students, alumni, friends of education, I'm honored to be a part of this inauguration ceremony for an outstanding educator and leader in our community, Dr. H. Lynn Cundiff. I speak in behalf of the Jordan School District Board of Education and Administration in expressing our pleasure in having the opportunity to work with President Cundiff and his staff in providing outstanding educational services to students. I was surprised and honored that within the first few days of his presidency at Salt Lake Community College last August, Dr. Cundiff visited me at my office to express his enthusiasm and excitement in working with the Jordan School District. What President Cundiff didn't know is that that day was my birthday. Occasionally, we receive surprises on our birthday. His visit to me was a most pleasant surprise, one that enriched my day and firmly established him in my mind as a caring, personable, forward-thinking, relationship-building individual. I have had the pleasure of visiting with him and his lovely wife, Glenda, in their home and have been made to feel like an old friend. Thank you, President and Mrs. Cundiff, for being people of integrity, kindness, caring, and strength in our community. Public education and higher education share a common commitment to facilitate our students' quest for knowledge, discovery, personal growth, and expanded opportunities throughout their lives. Our respective organizations are literally the vehicles to the American dream. As public and higher education institutions, when our individual and collective organizational focus centers on the student, collaboration, cooperation, synergy, and increased opportunities for success of those students increases. In this setting of mutual trust and respect, seamless transitions from high school to college can occur. Student learning is accelerated, resources are maximized to the benefit of all, and mutual interest solutions to challenges are discovered. On April the 8th, 1998, the Jordan School District and the Salt Lake Community College explored an innovative idea to strengthen our efforts in providing quality applied technology education to our students. Those ideas, first sketched and recorded on a paper napkin by President Frank Budd in a restaurant in West Jordan, were the beginnings of what has become the Jordan Applied Technology Center West Jordan campus, proudly located on the site of the new Salt Lake Community College Jordan campus. Under President Cundiff's outstanding leadership and support, we have developed a synergistic partnership providing cutting-edge educational programs for students that are seamlessly articulated between the Jordan School District and the Salt Lake Community College. This partnership was helped along by the legislature to acquire the land, for which we are deeply appreciative. But most of the substance of our working relationship came about because of because three independent boards, one the Jordan School District Board of Education, the others the Community College Board of Directors and the Regents, saw the needs of students, looked for solutions, and then made it happen. We will share space, resources, ideas, and even problems. However, the most important thing we share is our focus on students and their success. That's what keeps us anchored, keeps us committed, and keeps us working so well together. President Cundiff has the needed vision for education today and in the future. We in the Jordan School District are honored to work with him as president of the Salt Lake Community College, not only as an educational colleague, but as a trusted friend. Congratulations and welcome, President Cundiff, and we extend you our support and commitment to a lasting relationship.
President Cundiff, I am honored to pay tribute to you today on this historic occasion of your inauguration as the sixth president of Salt Lake Community College. I bring you greetings from those within our system of higher education who share the role of president. And I wonder if we could have the house lights up just a little. I'd like the presidents, as I name you, to please stand so you can be recognized. First, University of Utah, President Bernie Machen. Representing Utah State, right along here. I've never known a president to be bashful. Right down here. Representing Utah State University, Kermit Hall, is Dr. Craig Peterson. Weber State University, President Paul Thompson. Southern Utah University, President Steve Binion. Utah Valley State College, President Kerry Romsberg. Dixie State College, President Bob Huddleston, and College of Eastern Utah, President Grace Jones. Representing LDS Business College, President Stephen Woodhouse is here as a representative of our in-state private institution partners. Thank you. These individuals and those close to them fully understand the unique demands of the college presidency, demands which you and your wife, Glenda, now know well. You and they also know the rewards which come with this special and rewarding role, this meaningful, challenging role, this stewardship of an institution of higher education. And all of you, all of these individuals, would likely agree with the words of a longtime former president, Herman Wells, of Indiana University, and I quote, "With full knowledge of the trauma, travail, blood, sweat, and tears the office demands, if I were young and given the opportunity, I would eagerly undertake the glorious chore again." Unquote. On behalf of the State Board of Regents, Chair Charlie Johnson will issue charges to you today that the Regents have identified as your major areas of responsibility as you lead this very fine institution. And these reflect the issues of the search committee that was so well chaired by Regent Pamela Atkinson, with representation of all the various constituent groups. And as you know, Lynn, your selection as president of Salt Lake Community College resulted from a very careful, deliberative process. You emerged as the top candidate because of your extensive experience in higher education, primarily with community colleges, your vision for what this institution is and can be, coupled with your leadership abilities and your superb interpersonal skills. We are confident that as you work unitedly with your administration, with your faculty, staff, students, alumni, and community leaders that your administrative tenure will be very successful. And we will celebrate you as president of Salt Lake Community College over and over again. The charges that you receive from Chair Johnson will be fully utilized and realized throughout your tenure. President Cundiff, you are a part of a well-balanced system of higher education in the state of Utah. You have already established yourself as a strong advocate for Salt Lake Community College, as well as a president that recognizes the strength and the balance in the entire system and the other eight institutions that bring such rich diversity and roles to the residents of Utah. As your colleagues, your fellow presidents, and I, we pledge to you our full support and wish you and Glenda much success in your presidency, and know that we are fully with you and behind you. Congratulations.
Students, faculty, staff, platform guests, I want to thank you for this opportunity to be here today to meet you and greet my friends Lynn and Glenda Cundiff. I am most pleased to be here. I visited your fair city 2 years ago on a honeymoon trip that brought me and my husband to Salt Lake City, and I'll admit that I saw the world through rose-colored glasses at that time, but I can confirm now that your city is as fair as it seemed to me then. Immediately, I understood why Lynn and Glenda Cundiff were attracted by your lovely surroundings, but now I have a fuller understanding of their attraction to Salt Lake Community College because I have now encountered your people. Your hospitality matches the southern variety for which Georgia enjoys a much-deserved reputation, and we invite you to visit us. President and Mrs. Cundiff, I bring you very special and warm greetings from Floyd College and from the other 33 institutions and more than 200,000 students of the University System of Georgia. This opportunity to speak on behalf of all of these people may be my last, because as you know, I have announced my retirement this week, and that makes me particularly proud to be here with the nostalgia and the perspective of one who is also undergoing a passage to bring my greetings to you. Lynn Cundiff led Floyd College for 8 years and brought vision and energy and insight and boldness to the enterprise. Tom Daniel, the Georgia Chancellor's right-hand man, once said with respect to Lynn, however, that vision is a wonderful thing, but there is a fine line between vision and hallucination. I am pleased to report to you that Lynn was able to stay on the right side of that line most of the time. I joined Lynn's team for the last 4 of his 8 years and found a college energized by 3 new teaching sites, an invigorated cable TV service, and a laptop computer project about to unfold that would transform our college for all time. Lynn allowed people to dream new dreams. He asked, why not? He looked for means to accomplish ends. He put educational opportunities in the paths of people so they had to trip over them and make a conscious decision to pursue them or not. They could not ignore them. And he made it very hard for potential students to say no. He worked us very hard, to be sure, to fill those dreams and make those opportunities a reality. Lynn's efforts appropriately extended beyond the college. He was active in the local Chamber of Commerce, the United Way. He mentored local youth, and he was active in the arts community and in his local church. He knew the legislative delegation and the business leaders as his friends. The college is, after all, a collection of people with a common purpose. Lynn Cundiff articulated that common purpose clearly for the college. And even with his departure, those people who make up the college now, the faculty, the staff, the community, the students, have not deviated in the least from his fundamental belief that technology is a tool that can help transform lives and that it must be available to all students, not just those who go to highly selective institutions. And so, Lynn and Glenda, I bring you words from your friends back home. You are a part of our lives, and we need to catch you up on some of the happenings from time to time, and now is a good time. Steve Porch, the chancellor of the University System of Georgia, wants you to know that he has concluded that Bill Gates was wrong when he said Floyd College was among the most wired colleges in the nation. It was Lynn Cundiff who was the most wired. And the chancellor's days are now calmer. Bruce Jones, an academic division chair at Floyd College, reports that Tom Berry now prefers electronic textbooks over printed ones. Now you have to understand that this is revolutionary. Tom is a founding member of the college faculty, hired in 1970, and 3 years ago refused to use email. We thought he would retire before he would go technical. Bruce also wants you to know that airport traffic has been reduced in Rome so much now that you are not flying your plane in and out, that the airport authority has been able to repair the runways. So if you come back to visit now, it'll be smooth landings. I was on that plane to Wake Forest, and I can personally attest to some that have not been so smooth. Penny Wills, the Vice President for Student Development, reports that Barbara Myers is looking west to find a lead for Music Man. Penny interviewed with Lynn for her job as he left a stage production in full costume and full makeup. She knows his passion for the theater. Carla Patterson, the director of the TV station, wants you to check FCTV's new streaming video signal at the Extended Learning website. That's one of your dreams, now a reality. David Mathis, the director of a summer youth program, wants you to know that the disadvantaged youth of Northwest Georgia continue to thank you for putting the laptop computers in their hands each summer. And he reports that your idea has now grown into a model for all of the national youth sports programs across the country. And that brings me to Jeff Patey and Rob Latrello, our computer geniuses. They send their warm wishes. They want you to know that they loved the opportunity that you gave them to be on the cutting edge of their field, although some of us were sure at times it was the bleeding edge. They both love to play with gadgets about as much as you do. And they asked to know if you have any openings for them here. Now, I told them that I would not bring them that message to you, but they assured me that they wouldn't come for less than three times of the money, and I hope you can't afford them. Sandy Briscar, our PR director, wants you to know that the circles under her eyes have finally begun to fade. She reports that the Chronicle of Higher Education has finally taken her off its speed dial since you left Floyd, but she does want you to know that she has forwarded your number to them here. Lynn Bacon, the head of enrollment management, wants you to know that while she misses you, Lynn is pleased to be known now simply as Lynn and not Lynn the woman. And finally, Barbara Griffith, your beloved former administrative assistant, wants you to know that she is still waiting for the window you promised her in her office. Sound like the chatter of old friends? I really hope so. And I hope that your new friends hear the warmth from Georgia. In addition to being a dynamic president and first lady for Salt Lake Community College, Lynn and Glenda will also be among your best friends in just a short while. To my friend Lynn Cundiff, congratulations on your inauguration as president of Salt Lake Community College, and best wishes for a personally satisfying and professionally productive administration.
I extend to you an open invitation to return to the rolling hills of Northwest Georgia, but I know you will be happy here, surrounded by snow-capped mountain peaks and students, faculty, and staff who will benefit from your leadership. God bless to both of you. May your days be warm, your cloud ceilings high, and your staff tireless.
President and Mrs. Cundiff, Board of Regents, trustees, presidents, educators, and especially students, it is a great honor for me to be here and represent the governor in the state of Utah and welcoming this great couple to our state officially. Now, I must admit, Dr. Lord, Georgia's loss is tremendous, but our gain is wonderful. And we're delighted to be here. You know, I consider Salt Lake Community College a miracle. Now, it isn't a miracle that it has grown and you've expanded to all and added many programs. But back in the mid-80s, I happened to chair a task force with Senator Chuck Peterson from Provo. It had half regents and half legislators. And as a result of that task force, we determined we had to expand our community college system. We could no longer send the vast majority of our students for lower division to the two research institutions. And we had to make some changes. And so I had the proud honor of carrying the bill that gave this institution the name Salt Lake Community College, and the bill which mandated those research institutions to accept credit from all community colleges. That was a long time ago. And the miracle is that for once, the vision of the task force happened to be reality. Oh, if all the other task forces I'd serve on had had that same miracle. But we stand today at the threshold of developing a whole new vision. And I'm certain that that vision is in great hands. I don't care if sometimes it's solutionary. I don't care if sometimes you have to cut back a little on the vision, but think big and grow and make changes and meet the needs of the students. I'd like to tell you about three students I know. The first two I couldn't find because somehow you keep them so busy they never answer their phones and they don't have message systems. So I've changed the names of the first two. I know Amy. Amy was a little rebellious in high school, ended up getting pregnant at 16, marrying, having two other children, and at the age of 24, her husband decided he needed to renew his childhood and set about traveling elsewhere. As far as I know, she's never heard from him again. What does a mother do without even a high school diploma? She goes on welfare. But Amy quickly determined to support her children, she had to get her GED. And in getting that, she found she loved studying and that she had some real talents. And so, despite the fact that she's had to work, she's a student here and has a great love of people and plans to go into nursing, I think, at Weber College after she graduates. Rick comes from a family who never thought of higher education. But after high school, he went into the Air Force and found he had a knack with technology and computers. But he got married and soon had children, had a job, but found that he was stymied. He had an high school degree, but found that people with college degrees were advancing far faster than he. So for the last 4 years, he's been taking classes, working, struggling to get through the institution, but he will. The third, I haven't changed his name because it's my grandson, Ben. Now, Ben is one of three other children that's gone to this institution. He's 21, has spent 2 years in serving his church, and is back. A potential marvelous scholar. But so far, our conversations have not been about deep philosophical educational pursuits. They have centered more on girls and cars. And indeed, his love of cars is hindering his education because he has to work to support that habit. But underneath those momentary priorities is a wonderful student. If only he comes across the right mentors at Salt Lake Community College. And so you have a challenge of meeting all their needs, their unique needs. They're a cross-section. Amy and Rick probably need to get through the classes as fast as they can. They need the luxury of being able to stay and study at midnight. They need the luxury of moving ahead and recognizing the many skills they have gained already in life. Ben probably needs some one-on-one and some deep discussions on a more academic nature of encouragement. He's really wonderful, and I can guarantee you 50 years from now, I'll come back and tell you a marvelous story of what he's done. But those are the challenge. Keep all those three in your vision. As you look ahead at this institution, you will have marvelous scholars, though some of them may arrive later in life. You will have those with great needs, physical needs, scholarships, support. And you will have young students, not certain what they're going to major in, but full of expectancy and life. And with the right direction, they too can become marvelous, outstanding scholars and give back to this state a great deal. May your vision include all of these students and even more with different backgrounds, different life stories to tell. This is a great institution. It has fulfilled the vision we had back in the mid-80s. May it continue to grow. May it continue to meet the needs of this community. Thank you, President Cundiff, for deciding to make your home in Salt Lake.
I'm hearing the face I'm seeing, the
Next on the program, we were privileged to have Mrs. Glenda S. Cundiff introduce her husband. And I recall when we selected Lynn Cundiff as our new president, little did we know that we would get two for one as part of his serving as president. Glenda is a gracious, marvelous, talented woman who has served so well at the college. And she's always by Lynn's side, and it's really a pleasure to have her. And I told her today that if she wanted to have the last word, I would give that to her after her husband speaks. So I have the absolute discretion on that. After Glenda's introduction, Charles Johnson, chair of the Utah State Board of Regents, will conduct the investiture. We will then be pleased to hear from President Cundiff. At the conclusion of the president's remarks, the benediction will be offered by the Most Reverend George Niederauer of the Roman Catholic Diocese of Salt Lake. After the benediction, will you all please arise as the President's party recesses from the stage, at which point you are invited to attend a reception hosted by President and Mrs. Cundiff in the East Foyer.
Thank you, Randall. I would like to acknowledge the Board of Regents, the Board of Trustees, distinguished guests of Salt Lake City, Salt Lake Community College, students, friends, present and on the internet, and President Cundiff. This is a special day of celebration, a celebration of new leadership and continued dedication to this fine institution. I think I'm honored to introduce the president to you today. When Judd called and asked me to do this, and he says, and we want to keep it, you know, fun, kind of like a this is your life thing. And I thought, oh my goodness, does he know what he's asking me to do? Because you know, 38 and a half years of marriage, you think you've had chaos. But I promised that I would behave myself and try to be professional. I would like to begin with two scriptures, because everything that I will be telling you about Lynn centers around these scriptures. The first one is John 15:5. Jesus says, I am the vine, you are the branch. Those who remain in me and I in them will produce much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. And Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The word I want to focus on to describe Lynn is diligence, because he is hard working. He is determined, he is humbled, and he takes great care in what he does. His dedication to serving others and helping them succeed is a trademark of his leadership. This diligent man came into the world on August 27, 1943. Born to Esther and Harold Cundiff, and evidently was so determined to accomplish at a young age that his parents decided they could not have any more children. So that means he was an only child and spoiled rotten. Those are my words, not his mother's. His mother was always telling everybody that he was the perfect little boy. Never, and she did emphasize never, did anything wrong. These are her words from a poem that she wrote to him. Whatever joy my life has known has been because of you. Through all the years, my pride has grown in everything you do. I'm sure his sweet voice and those innocent baby blue eyes and the right words to her were just exactly what she wanted to hear. And all I can say is, oh, a mother's love. The first time I met Lynn was in the cafeteria at college. Even though we were born in the same hospital in St. Louis, Missouri, in the same month, and he was a basketball player, and I was a cheerleader, not in the hospital, back at the college. And I was the cheerleader. That day in the cafeteria, he approached me and asked me for a date. Well, I accepted and went out with him, and 2 weeks later, he asked me to take his class ring. 2 weeks after that, he asked me to marry him, and he wouldn't take no for an answer. Determined? Diligent? I guess so. He told me, I just can't live without you. But afterwards, he said, I don't know how to live with you. But in his determination, he kept right on working at it. And two children and five great-grandchildren, not great-grandchildren, five grandchildren that are great. He is still proving his diligence as a father, as a husband, and as a grandfather.
Growing up with the world's most active parent
of this day of celebration for their father. So they have sent a video to show their appreciation for him, which we're going to view at this time.
When I look back at growing up with the world's most active parents, I've always seen a loving mother and a very diligent father. I remember a father whom in the basement of our St. Joseph, Missouri home taught my brother and I the hustle. How cool I thought it was that my father knew the newest dance craze. There were times, though, that I questioned whether or not he was crazy. Like the time he had planned a family canoe trip to Jack's Fork River in Missouri, we were all so excited. I imagined the beautiful things that we would see and the wildlife that would cross our paths. As we arrived where we would depart on the river, my attentive father handed my brother and I a canoe paddle and said, "There's your canoe." Now, I love my brother, but putting us together in a canoe was sure to create problems. I thought my father had surely lost it. So the trip began down what seemed the longest river ever, my brother in back guiding the canoe and myself in front taking orders from him. I have to admit losing control of my paddle a couple of times and really splashing Gary good, only to receive the same treatment back from him. After two long days of being with my brother, we were at the end and we had made it. I am proud to say that we did not tip over once. You'll have to ask Mom and Dad how many times they tipped. I really didn't get to see much wildlife, although I'm sure that the animals that were around had a good laugh at my brother and I trying to get along long enough to make it down the river. As a parent, I look back at that time and see it with a whole new light now. My dad was trying to teach us diligence, the very trait in which he possesses so well. As I try to raise my son and daughter, I attempt to teach them the traits to which my father instilled in my brother and I. I have thanked him many times but it doesn't seem enough. So thanks again, Dad, for raising Gary and I to be God-fearing children and for teaching us to love one another. I appreciate you and love you very much. Congratulations on your new position, even if it did take you halfway across the United States. We are all very proud of you. Oh, and by the way, I would never put my children in a canoe together down the river. I would probably never see them again. But I did take my husband, who had never been canoeing before, after going down rapids backwards and around in circles many times, although not tipping over once thanks to my great skills. We do have a whole new appreciation for one another. It has always been my thought that as you are teaching marriage classes to couples, that to graduate from the class, they should have to go canoeing together and make it all the way to the end. It would work wonders, I'm sure. Congratulations again. We love you.
Congratulations, Grandma. We love you.
Hi, I'm Gary Cundiff, and this is my wife, Sarah.
Hi.
This is our oldest daughter, Caroline. She's 4.
Hi. Hi, Papa. We love you.
And this is Mary Kate. She is 3.
Hi, Papa. I love you.
And Clay here is a rambunctious 7 months old.
Hi, Papa. All right.
Well, there are many things that I could say about my father that would be appropriate for today. By now, you've heard of our adventures on canoe trips. You know, Sue and I had that whole thing under control from the start. Then there was a summer that my dad made me take modern dance class. Okay, he said he would help me with my footwork, my foot speed, and my coordination. You know, I probably should have told him that those things were inherited from him. The most telling sign of a great leader is that they make the people around them better by pushing them, by pulling them, and by carrying them if necessary. You see, my father has the ability to see valuable talents in everyone around him. You've had the opportunity now for 8 months to be around him, and you can see that his mission is to make sure that all of us reach our potential. My most positive and hated memory is that he constantly pushed me to excel. Dad, I want to tell you thanks for all the times you threw me out of the house to practice basketball, even when there was a foot of snow on the ground. I think he got mad because I could beat him one-on-one when I turned 12. Also, Dad, for the times that you forced me to practice with your college basketball teams, even though I was in the 6th grade. And you know, then there were the times that you would correct my math homework late at night, wake me up at 5:30 in the morning, just to make sure that I got it right before I went to school. I could go on and on about the way he pushed me to excel. Even though sometimes I hated that he pushed me so hard, now I realize that really, he was carrying me. For you see, when I understood the talent and the potential that I had, he stopped pushing and got out of my way to let me succeed or fail on my own. My advice to many of you is to realize your potential quicker than I did. Lynn Cundiff, any success that I've achieved is a direct result of the drive and leadership values that you've instilled in me. Congratulations on all of your achievements. I'm very proud to call you Dad.
And we are very proud of our children and grandchildren. Our daughter's tape was being done by her 10-year-old son, so it was a little... But he thought he was very special in getting to do that for his pawpaw. So we appreciate them doing that. Lynn does have some hobbies. You've already heard basically of one of them, because some of his toys get quite expensive. But it had always been a desire of his to fly a plane. So his determination and his diligence took him right into the pilot seat. Scuba diving seemed to be a challenge as well. He mastered that and then taught it in one of the colleges where we were. Canoeing and sailing tested his diligence, so he went for it. Better in a canoe than in the sailboat. He about turned the sailboat over with me in it. horseback riding, canoeing, water skiing, snow skiing. He decided he didn't really need to prove anything to anyone else, so he stays on the green slopes. But I guess the best one that he's mastered is the beach. He continually tells me I could really become a beach bum. But I know the drive that's within him and the determination and diligence that's still there, so I've never really believed him and took him up on that. He has proven his diligence in his career, first as a basketball coach and an excellent math teacher. I still have some of the letters that parents sent me of students that went through his math class. 7 years at the high school level, 5 years at the four-year level, and 2 years at the community college level. It was at the community college level where his determination and diligence led his team to the national championship and to him being named Coach of the Year. Upon his completion of his doctorate from Southern Illinois University at Carbondale, he became Dean of Students, Athletic Director, and shortly afterwards, Vice President of Pratt Community College in Pratt, Kansas. But I have to tell you, between you and me, the kids and I did at least 50% of that work on that doctoral that he had. I tried to get him to put all four of our names on there, but they wouldn't do it. His determination and diligence led him to become the Executive Vice Chancellor of the Alabama two-year college system, where he served for 5 years. Then he needed a new challenge and became the second president of Floyd College in Rome, Georgia. And it was here where he received the great honor of being nominated to carry the Olympic torch. That was a great honor for him, but what made it even greater was he got to carry it right in front of one of our campuses. He also starred in several plays, the last one being Hello, Dolly, and was always involved in community affairs. That was a good one. I couldn't find the one to kiss the pig. And he still is, basically. Time for a new challenge. Go west, young man, go west, came the call. And so he did. In the 9 months that he has been at Salt Lake Community College, his diligence and determination to serve has proven his leadership abilities of courage, of strength, of vision, and of wisdom. So this perfect little boy, who could do no wrong, is continuing to blaze a path to help others be diligent to set their goals, and with all their talents and abilities and God's help, to succeed in their every endeavor. Lynn believes that his courage, his strength, his vision, and his wisdom comes from the belief that Jesus is the vine and he is the branch. He must remain in Jesus and Jesus in him so that he can produce much fruit. For apart from Jesus, Lynn can do nothing. And Lynn can do all things through Christ who strengthens him. It is my privilege to introduce to you today President H. Lynn Cundiff.
To those of you who don't know, I'm not Lynn Cundiff, although that introduction may have sounded like that, but I'd like to be. That was great, Glenda, and very interesting tributes paid today. The music has been wonderful. This is a glorious day. In behalf of the Board of Regents, let me thank each of you for being here. Your support of Salt Lake Community College, the energy that you bring in that support will continue to drive Glenda and Lynn as they go forward. And I mean, maybe if we give him too much energy, he'd be hyperactive, but it's been great to learn a lot more about you, so thank you for that. As we start this process of giving him official titles, I know this position has been rather easy so far. It's going to get even easier after we give you some authority, President. It is something that the Regents have learned over a period of time, and we share this with you. that there is one duty and responsibility that we have that surpasses all of others. It is the most far-reaching and greatest impact that we have, and that is the issue of selecting a new president. And when we get 100, sometimes 125 candidates, and can get down to that one selection and get people like this, it's a marvelous process. In my case, I talked with governors and former governors in Georgia and a lot of people. Hundreds of hours were spent by Pamela Atkinson and the search committee. It's quite a process. I will tell you that I have been chair of the Board of Regents now for 3.5 years. In that 3.5 year period, we have or will choose 5 new presidents. Now that's out of 9, so more than 50% will have less than 3.5 years with our system. So it is a marvelous process. Today, it is my duty and my pleasure to give to Lynn Cundiff a charge as part of the investiture. And it's just 2 or 3 items that I want to mention as his charge in the period of time that he serves as president of Salt Lake Community College. First charge relates always to the students. It's easy to say students first. Intellectually, we know that the students will be up sitting in these seats in a next generation. They will be the lieutenant governor, the president of a college. What we don't know is which students will achieve that. And it's hard to guess in advance. And as Olin said, sometimes students develop faster than others. Some need something, an extra boost. The banks and financial institutions have a program they call Fresh Start. You've heard them. They say, have credit problems? Come to us for a fresh start. Recognizing that not everyone moves along at the same level, and people often need a fresh start. And I thought Lieutenant Governor Walker gave us a good example of that. Every student counts. So, Mr. President, my first charge to you is to measure every major decision that you make by the following question. How will my decision impact our students? If you will spread that thought throughout the campus, we'll be on solid grounds. Next, and somewhat along the same lines, it is preserving what I consider to be the bedrock of this institution. Salt Lake Community College knows its mission as well as any institution that we have in this state. Its impact on thousands of students, businesses, the community is phenomenal. Many of the students will go on to a 4-year institution. Many will go into the workplace. There is presently a major decision being made in this state as to the future of applied technology education. Much of that discussion centers around the service area served by you, Salt Lake and Tooele County. Many are concerned that if applied technology education is put under higher education, high school students or at-risk adults will be left by the wayside. And in a short time, we will have changed the face of education in this state. Now, you have been here, Mr. President. You have the confidence of elected official. You have dealt, as Superintendent Newbold said, forcefully and faithfully with public education. And so there is one thing that is certain. If people will get to know President Lynn Cundiff and get to know Salt Lake Community College, they'll feel better about the role and mission of applied technology education in this state. So your charge is as follows. Continue to showcase this great institution. Continue to demonstrate your leadership in the energy area. And finally, I'm going to ask you to spend a considerable extra amount of your energy in the short run in helping this state find the model for applied technology education that will survive my role as chair of the Board of Regents and your role as president of this institution. This is an important policy matter, and I charge you to get actively involved with a lot of energy. Next, I want to talk about financial resources. You have a very fertile mind, as we've proven today with some of the stories about Dr. Cundiff. And with more finances, who knows what you could do? Well, as you have found, that this is a state that, although well-managed, is not awash in riches. Your institution is dependent upon state funding, tuition from students, and from your partnerships with business and industry. On student tuition, we asked the question. We said we'll always ask this question: what is the impact on students? On student tuitions, we get two answers. One is, on this side, we put a financial burden on students by raising tuition. On this side, we have resources to enable them to have a more quality education. It's not that we have an answer, but asking the question is important as to the impact on students. You have demonstrated, President, your involvement with the Lieutenant Governor, the Governor, legislature, and your ability to work in the state finance system. The area where you can make a larger difference is with respect to partnerships with business and industry and with donors. Your charge is to expand the fundraising efforts, the results of which will pay large dividends and will allow you some freedom to do some of the things your fertile mind would like to do. And I know you have a long, long list. Now, a word about technology and education, because others have mentioned this, and during the interview process, your selection, it became clear that you were actively interested in technology. In fact, I guess we all have a President Cundiff story. When I talked with someone in the state of Georgia, they said, you know, Dr. Cundiff is big on technology. He said he called me once and said, I have this technology project. He said, I listened to him for about 2 minutes, and I said, what in the world are you thinking of? And he said, but he was so persuasive that he convinced me of this project. And he says, the strange thing is, he was right about it. Now, in telling this story, I'm not going to tell you that you can bring every project to us. I hope you understand that. But I would not want you to stop thinking about projects and things that you could do. Technology is simply the symbol of the great changes that are taking place in higher education. There is nothing so constant as change. Much of your success will depend upon how well you identify and respond to the needs of this community, business, and industry. You are here to a great extent because of your creative thinking. Your charge, then, is to continue to explore the outer boundaries. And I don't even think I needed to tell him that one. It sounds to me like he always does that. In the end, it's all about balance. Paying attention to students, faculty, staff, elected officials, business people, community people, Board of Regents, Board of Trustees, the list goes on and on. Attention paid to the contribution of and morale of faculty and staff will serve all the rest of us stakeholders well. Pay attention to that group. Now, I've watched your energy. We've heard of your energy. It's now becoming almost legend. My final charge to you is this. If it stops being enjoyable, stop what you're doing, take a time out with Glenda, and revitalize yourself. Set yourself, for those who didn't hear that, Glenda said yes. When you're finally revitalized, jump back into it. We have full faith in you, Mr. President, and we want to keep you here for a long time. Now, if you'll come forward, President Cundiff, and Glenda, would you come forward, please, also? This is the official portion of it. By virtue of the authority invested in me by the State Board of Regents, it is my distinct pleasure to place this inaugural medallion, I will show you the inaugural medallion, around your neck and to proclaim and certify to all that H. Lynn Cundiff has been duly appointed President of Salt Lake Community College, fully invested with all of the rights, honors, and responsibilities of this significant and important office in the Utah system of higher education. Congratulations.
Thank you, Charlie.
Congratulations. This is very heavy, and Glenda and I are going to do this together. We normally don't like to weight our presidents down too early, but this is a little different. Got it?
I didn't know this was going to be a roast. But I'm glad that I have two friends here. One is Frank Budd, the past president upon whom I can blame everything. And so I'm glad that he's alive and well. And I've been accused of being visionary, and I know that visionary people die being taunted as fools with no money. And so when that time comes, my friend Bernie Machum from the University of Utah has told me I can be the assistant basketball coach at the university. There are some days I'm very close to that. I need to say thank you to everyone on the platform, to all of you gathered here in this audience, the platform guests, to all my friends who have brought greetings. Thank you so much for your kind and hurtful comments. To a wonderful faculty and staff, and I'm very sincere about that. Between you and the students, you make life worth living every day. To an outstanding student body, I've learned much from you. And Jake may be the best speech giver in the place today. So, and finally, I need to say to my wife, I'm not sure I can come home.
Glenda has been my cheerleader since the day I met her. I think that will not change. I pray it will not change. And I'm very excited to have her as a part of my life, because she truly does bring balance, and she brings direction, and she has a whip that she uses on a regular basis to keep me in line. I miss my children and grandchildren. I feel very close to them, and it was good to see them. To Lieutenant Governor Olin Walker, thank you. I appreciate you being here today. You honor Salt Lake Community College. To my legislative friends in the audience, I've never worked with people that were more giving of their time and thoughtful about this college and about the legislative process than I found in this state, and I thank you. To Commissioner Foxley and the Board of Regents, Charlie Johnson, I consider you not just to be employers, but friends, and that we have a joint mission that we need to accomplish for the citizens of this state. And to Randall Mackey and my Board of Trustees, who are wonderful individuals, who are very supportive, I thank you for being here today and for putting up with some goofy ideas from time to time. And to all of you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for sharing this day with Salt Lake Community College, because that's really what it's about. And so with that, let's begin. Let's have a conversation. I need to say to you that Salt Lake Community College began on September 14, 1948 at the Old Troy Laundry in downtown Salt Lake. We had 246 students, 145 of which were veterans, and the tuition was $78. We had 24 full-time faculty in 1948, and I think I saw some of them around the halls last week. The average salary for faculty at that point in time was $2,400, with a maximum of $4,600. The first president was Howard B. Gunderson. His salary was $6,000. Madam Commissioner, Mr. Chairman, not much has changed. I'm sorry.
Except for the tuition, yeah. In 1967, we became Utah Technical College, and tuition was $384. And during the first two phases of our development, we grew strong roots in technical education, which we are still in place today. And today, we're Salt Lake Community College. It's the 27th largest community college in the United States. We have, by the next 2 weeks, we will have counted this year 57,000+ students who have gone through this institution this year. 23,000 of those was of a credit nature, and 34,000 were non-credit, training for business and industry. We have partners, and we've formed partnerships with business and industry throughout this valley. We're very pleased about that. We're very pleased about the concurrent enrollment that we're able to cooperate with the local school districts on. And we're very proud of the 17,000 students we have attending with us that are enrolled in something called applied technology education. And our commitment is to those students. We are the 15th largest community college in the nation with regard to the number of graduates. And I think that says something about our wonderful faculty and staff who not only take a large mass of students, but graduate proportionally more than our peers. We currently have over 1,500 full-time employees, and this fall, we will have new programs in vet tech and biotech to complement our large and successful array of medical programs. By and large, Salt Lake Community College is a wonderful success story. Now, many of you think that this day is about Salt Lake Community College, and perhaps even some of you came to think that this was about me. But I need to tell you that I think Melody Lambert's in the audience today. Melody, are you here? Would you stand? This is Melody's birthday, and we really came to... We really came to honor Melody and sing happy birthday. But because I hope to be on this stage someday, I don't want to lead in singing today. Perhaps in the fall. Over those 50-some years, we have truly gone from power sewing to power computing. And that is the place that we've come from. What you're seeing is a new logo and a new theme that we'll be using at Salt Lake Community College. And I want to try to tell you how we put this logo together as we move forward. But we have much to celebrate. And so today we celebrate our technical heritage, our commitment to applied technology education, our partnerships with the Jordan School District, the Granite School District, and others in our midst that have become our close and abiding friends. We are very thankful for the partnerships we have. We're also very thankful for our partnership with the Wasatch Front South, ATC. And as we start to build a new logo, we think that the first cusp of that logo, if you will, is based upon our heritage. And not just our heritage, but our commitment to technical education and applied technology education throughout this valley and the students we serve. We're very proud of our students and our graduates and our faculty and staff who daily make an impact on this valley and this world. And the truth of the matter is, we do live in a technology world. Our labs have gone, as we've said, from power sewing to robotics and CAD and visual graphic arts, and all in a very short period of time. You can probably remember when you could take your car, now let me rephrase it, some of you can remember when you could take your car to a mechanic and he would say, well, pop the hood and let me listen to the engine. That doesn't happen anymore. As a matter of fact, our automobile mechanics today need high-skilled electronics, they need almost calculus, and they certainly need computer technology to be able to work on any car in today's world. And that's what we've been able to do as a community college. That's what you've been able to do as a community college, is to move with the times in order that our students have access and have opportunity to excel. We know that knowledge doubles about every 18 months. And we also know that wherever knowledge-based workers cluster, in communities large or small, that's where wealth will accumulate in the future. And part of our goal is to help that knowledge-based economy so that we can help them move forward. As a matter of fact, Michael Desjardins from the Harvard Business School said this: today there is no such thing as a low-tech company, as a low-tech industry, only low-tech companies who will rapidly cease to exist. However, I need to tell you how I really feel about the use of technology. And you've heard many people talk about it today. I really don't care about technology. What I do care about is the learning environment. And I do care about affecting a positive learning environment, both for our faculty and staff and our students. And if technology is a piece of that, then that's part of the application that we need to apply. And yes, we're looking at doing some things electronically. For example, we're about to be a totally unwired institution. I said the other day to my friend Bernie that I went to the legislature and asked for $2 million, and I got $500,000 to go wireless. He asked for nothing, and he got $1 million to go wired. I don't understand. But I have a big ball of wire that I'm going to present him at the first opportunity, because he certainly must know something that I don't know about technology. Our institutions of our 12 campuses, currently about half of them are wireless. And by this fall, the rest of them will be. We will live in a wireless world where we operate and move, and our faculty will have the best equipment available to be able to assist student learning. We will initiate a number of blended classes. As you know, we're already in that process. And technology becomes a key to the things that we do. And it is not the answer, but it is a piece of the solution for parking problems, building problems, and for communication problems that we continue to have throughout the valley. And so, as a part of that, we've developed a very neat piece of media for you. So won't you come with me now? I'll be quiet for a minute as we view an example of the escalation of the pace of change in our society. I wish I could take credit for that. But thanks to Bob and John and others, students even, who helped put that together. We think it demonstrates the pace of change. And we think it demonstrates the future of what Salt Lake Community College can become for the citizens of this state and this valley. So with all the emphasis on technology, what should we say to our liberal arts colleagues, our general education colleagues, and other disciplines of importance? You name it. What do we say to our other valued friends? Is there no longer a need for English or math or sciences or communication skills, investigative research, problem solving, the fine arts, because of technology? Nonsense. These skills are even more important. And so I want to speak to you today about a future and a direction for SLCC that complements and provides value added in a technological world. Issue number one, I call Salt Lake Community College to fully embrace diversity. Not just the diversity of race, although I think that is extremely important, but also the diversity of thought, the diversity of associations, the diversity of culture, and the diversity of our educational programs. Diversity takes more than one avenue. It is a multifaceted issue, and we need, as an institution, as a faculty, as a staff, and as a student body, to address it. I need to say to you that we seek to embrace diversity for the right reasons, not just to enhance our numbers or our FTEs, but to enhance the world of our faculty, our staff, and most important, our students. But having said that to you, let me talk to you a little bit about numbers that occur in this valley. Even though we lead the state as Salt Lake Community College with a number of minority students, number of diversity issues which we address in many ways, we still have not done enough. My view is that if we leave one life untouched, that we have failed as an institution. So therefore, I've requested Vice President Morgan, the Financial Aid Office, as well as the foundation, to double by next fall and triple by the following fall the number of scholarships and waivers for our minority population in this valley. We think it is a commitment that we need to make as an institution. And if we make a commitment as an institution with regard to diversity, then we can get to diversity of thought, we can get to diversity of culture, and we can serve this state in a more productive way. However, we must note, and I must tell you, that this will bring further change to our institution. And I know you don't want to hear that. Because of this one fact, it will cause our curriculum to expand and change to meet a different set of needs. It will cause our communication patterns, and lo and behold, even our teaching styles to change to meet a different set of needs. Our concept of student activities will change. And I would tell you that I believe that learning communities, which all of us support, both within and without the institution, will take on an even greater meaning with regard to a more diverse population. Secondly, I call SLCC, Salt Lake Community College, to embrace worldwide horizons. Because you see, everybody must contend with globalization. Now, is that to say that we don't want to be a part of the Salt Lake area? No, absolutely not. Is that to say that we don't want to have a mission and a role in the state of Utah? No, absolutely not. What it is saying is that if we're really going to educate the students who come to our institution, then we must give them a world view, not just a local view. We must reach out to the world for partnerships, and it's not just for their benefit. I mean, we as Americans often think, well, we can give them something that they don't have. Let me tell you, friends, that they can give us something that we've never thought of as well. So the world helps us expand our thinking, and it brings something to us. I need to tell you one story, if I might, about my wife. This fall, really in December, the Chinese Minister of Education, a lady by the name of Zilly Chin, was visited the University of Utah and then Salt Lake Community College, and we were very pleased to host him, as I know Bernie was. And during that afternoon and evening, as we spent time together, we exchanged gifts. And one of our faculty members made a wonderful peace pipe The Chinese didn't understand what a peace pipe was or what to put in it, but a wonderful peace pipe on a plaque that we gave Zilly Chin. She gave us some wonderful gifts as well. At the end of the evening, we were embracing and saying nice things to each other. And my wife was by my side, as she normally is, and she said to Zilly Chin, just being kind, that is a beautiful scarf. Without a moment's hesitation, the Minister of Education for the country of China took the scarf from around her neck and put it around my wife and said, you look lovely in that scarf. And as you can see, she would look lovely in anything. But what can we learn from that? You see, it was their ability to give something that they had to us to form a relationship, to form a friendship that would teach us much in our society and in the place where we work and live every day. It would teach our administrators much. It would teach our students much. But I would tell you, it would teach our faculty much as well. And we would all be wise to emulate that kind of giving as we move forward. Peter Drucker once said, there are two types of employees, students, etc. Those that are globally educated and those that are unemployed. And my concern is not about what we do about globalization for me or even for you. But my concern is, what do we do about globalization for our students? Because with the world that they're going to live in for the rest of their lives, how are they going to adapt if they don't have knowledge and understanding of that world? And there are only two ways to get that. You can get it by experience, or you can get it from a wonderful, caring faculty who have had those experiences and have that understanding. I propose that we be the people that help them gain that understanding. And so Salt Lake Community College is committed to a global education, and yet I would tell you, I think we need to do more. I call on all of us gathered here, the Board of Regents, the Board of Trustees, the Lieutenant Governor's Office, our friends in public education, to help us expand the knowledge of the world for our students and ourselves. It's not something we can do by ourselves. It's a mission that we must all undertake. I have two more, and I'll be through. I started to take my watch off and put it up here and tell you, my pastor, who just gave the opening prayer, does that every Sunday morning. It doesn't mean anything to him. He just puts it up there. Okay. I call on all of us to embrace the tenets of effective, productive leadership. And in the time of rapid change, I would tell you that we must have strong leaders. We must have strong leaders at the state level, the trustee level, at the regent level, the faculty level, the staff level, the administration, the student level, and even the presidential level. Probably where it matters least, if the truth is known. But leadership is a commitment. And I think there are values that are associated with leadership. And I try to live my life to emulate those values, and I hope I'm successful. Some of those values that I consider to be extremely important are, one, honesty. Two, ethical behavior. Three, a world view of the situation. And four, courage. And let me explain that one to you. Courage, in my mind, is a virtue. But I've come to believe that there are no virtues if you don't have courage. Because while you may be concerned about honesty or ethical behavior or moral values, if you don't have the courage to stand up, to speak the truth, to demonstrate ethical behavior, then I think you have nothing. And I would challenge all of us, myself included, to emulate those values. And I would further tell you that I believe in relationships. Relationships are extremely important to me. With my faculty colleagues, with the staff, the administration, and as Dr. Lard said earlier, we just don't have business relationship, we have friends, and we want to be a friend. And even though relationships are very important to me, I must say to you that a college where the culture is based upon the value of relationships instead of the value of performance, and leadership will never take giant strides forward. And I value relationships. But relationships without productivity, without effectiveness, to me become meaningless, because all of us have something we need to do for others, not just for ourselves. And so I challenge all of us in this room today to look at your leadership style. I can't lead this institution if we don't have faculty leaders. I can't lead this institution if we don't have student leaders, staff leaders, and leaders at the administrative level. I don't need more managers. This institution doesn't need more managers, and this state doesn't need more managers. It needs more leaders. And we on this platform and you in this audience today are the only people capable of doing those things in this state. And I challenge you to take on a leadership role, to be a leader of this institution, of this valley, in this state, no matter what your role in this institution is. And so I really believe that only through leadership will our institutional learning improve. And you know, I think we have to learn as an institution. And I ask you a question. Can you demonstrate for me that Salt Lake Community College is better at teaching, you choose the field, English, math, science, fine arts, technology, than we were 20 years ago? Now, I know that you can give me anecdotal evidence, but can you demonstrate to me effectively that we're better than we used to be? And I think that's a challenge for all of us. I look at my office every day, and can I demonstrate that I'm better than I was yesterday at helping students, at helping you? And so I challenge you to think the same way. I'm almost through. Hang on. Gouda once said, "We have come to a frightening conclusion that we are the decisive element. It is our professional approach that creates the climate. It's our daily actions that make the climate. And we, you and I, possess tremendous power to make a life miserable or a life joyous. We can be a tool of torture or an instrument of inspiration." And all the students said amen. "We can humiliate or humor, hurt or heal." You see, it's our response that decides whether a crisis is escalated or de-escalated. And it takes leadership. You and I, we must lead the way. There is nobody else to do it. I need you much more than you need me. But I need your leadership abilities. Finally, I call SLCC to be an institution dedicated to service. And I want to give you one example of one of my favorite scriptures, since Glenda used some as well. It comes from the 84th Psalm in biblical history. And there's a verse in there about verse 4 or 5 or 6, something through there, that says, "While passing through the valley of Baca, they make it a well, and the rain also filleth the pools." Now, the valley of Baca in Israel is a really good walk outside of Jerusalem. And really what it is a garbage dump. And in olden times when this was written, people had to walk through that valley as they left Jerusalem going in one direction. And the reference to the scripture really says this, because if you left afternoon on any day, you couldn't make it through the valley without spending the night there in the garbage dump. And what the scripture really refers to is to say, when you're going through trials and difficult things in your life, stop and dig a well, because somebody's going to come after you, and they need the same water, they need the same opportunity, and they need the same caring that you received while you were going through that trial. I think that says something to all of us. And I certainly think it says something about my life and the way that I want to live my life. But the verse that I really like is the next verse after it, which says, if you'll do this, you'll go from strength to strength. That you won't be tired, that you won't be frustrated, but you'll go from strength to strength. And isn't that what life is really about? The ability to help others and to serve, whether it be students or our colleagues or our fellow presidents or our wife or our spouse, whoever it may be. And so I think we need to be an institution dedicated to service, that an act of kindness truly can be shared. I want to say to you, currently we have over 450 students involved in service learning. We have between 20 and 25 faculty, who I'm very proud of, utilizing service learning as a part of their classroom. And we have another 400 students who are in volunteer service in the community. We'll have three service learning scholars this year that spend enough time in scholarship activities with regard to service that they'll receive a service learning scholar award. And all that's wonderful, and we celebrate all that is good at this institution. But I have to say to you, we need 5,000 students involved in service learning. We need 100 faculty to make this a priority. My board chair, Randall Mackey, and I also often have a conversation where he reminds me that students, individuals, and people who don't start giving back to the community, to their family, to their friends, early on in life, never gain that as an appreciative part of their personality or lifestyle. As in other roles that we need to help people understand, we need to help them understand about service, about the ability to give back, about the ability to care for others, and the ability to be effective while we're doing it. And so Jake set me up pretty good for this early on. It really is my favorite poem that he quoted. I didn't know he was good enough to catch it the first time I used it. But I think it's really important. And so with this, I close. And I thank you for being here. And I thank you for honoring Salt Lake Community College. It's indeed an opportunity for me to serve. And yes, I am the goofy guy with crazy ideas. But I'm also the person that cares about you. My wife is the person who really loves the people at this institution. The students have been so wonderful, such a wonderful group of students. It just, every day I look forward to going to work, and most of you know I come in about 7 or 7:15 every day. And my wife doesn't like that all the time, but I've got to work. I want to help. I want to be a part. I want to be a part of you. I want to help you lead. I want to be a part of people's lives, and I want to be able to give back to this wonderful community and state, and I trust that you feel the same way. So isn't it strange that princes and kings and clowns that caper in sawdust rings and common people like you and me